nice, happy way to start. Good morning. Well, so glad to see everyone here today. The blessing of your company is always, always good. I wanted to announce, remind you of a couple of things before we get started into worship. One, you have both prayer concern cards and registration cards. I believe it's a blue card. I don't have a copy here. That where we can get your name, address, email address so that we can keep in touch with you. We'd love to have that information. If you're visiting, we would love to have you fill that out and turn it in. Prayer request cards are also in front of you. If you have praises or concerns that you want to share, please fill them out, and they'll be picked up during the singing of our first hymn. And then today we are doing, we sort of shifted how we do missions offerings. We always do some kind of outreach mission besides for the needs of our congregation, which we have. You know, we have programs and things that we support here within the work of our church, but we also support offering needs out in the community. And the Council of Ministries decided last month that we were going to shift a little bit how we do things. So every fourth month, we have a special, it's like a national special offering. Last time it was retired ministers and missionaries offerings back in January. The next one will be next month, but then each month on the first Sunday, we take a communion offering, and we will focus on that communion offering on the first Sunday. But if you aren't prepared to make a donation to this particular offering today, we will accept offerings for the entire month for this special need in our community. And this month's offering is for Nourish Pierce County, which is the new name. You know, it's hard to make the shift when somebody changes the name and you're used to the old one. But those of you who've been around the community for a while will remember Fish Food Bank, and it's the same entity. They do the same outreach, and I just wanted to share with you their mission is to provide nutritious food and support services to people in need with compassion, dignity, and respect. And their vision is creating pathways from scarcity to security. Now, if you have any questions about Nourish Pierce County, Carolyn Farah is a volunteer. Now, I realize she works on the line. She doesn't do anything in the leadership or anything like that. She's a volunteer for the work that they do through Mason Methodist Church. But she might be able to tell you a little bit more about those programs. So I invite you to consider this as a special offering today. And thank you for being here. Let's do some praise and worship.
Please stand as you're able and join us in singing our praise music. And if you'll notice, we have an addition to our band this morning. Hannah has been working very... Yes, absolutely, yes.
You don't have hair, so.
Yeah, exactly. So she's been working very hard and taking lessons, so we're very proud of her. So please enjoy and sing along with us.
The sun comes up worship your holy name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Together wonderful to me. is what I long for. Faithfulness is what I need. Faithfulness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will and form it to yours, to yours, O Lord. Brokenness, brokenness is what I long for. Brokenness is what I need. Brokenness, brokenness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, to yours, O Lord. Righteousness, righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, O Lord. To yours, to yours, O Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Wow.
Would the kids come up and help me?
Yes.
No. I don't do this often, but a friend of mine made this stole for me several years ago when I did a sermon series based on one of my favorite people in the whole world.
Is that New York City?
No, that's Dr. Seuss' Cat in the Hat. A library.
New York
City. A library in New York City. Okay. So, why do I like Dr. Seuss? Anybody know? Go ahead, Mason.
He likes rhyming.
Because what?
He likes rhyming.
He likes rhyming? Okay, anything else? Yes, ma'am.
He likes to be
creative.
Yeah,
he's funny.
He makes really
funny characters and books. Yeah. But do you know why he does that? Dr. Seuss, Theodore Seuss Geisel, was an old man. Long ago he did all of his work, before you guys were even born. And he was a troublemaker. That's probably why I like him the most, because not that I'm a troublemaker, but Dr. Seuss was a troublemaker. And even before anybody else did, he wrote things about Nazi Germany and about Hitler. This is wrong. And his career took a couple steps backwards because he did what he thought was right. He did what he thought the world needed to know and to hear, even though it wasn't something that would make him friends. And so his career, instead of going forward at that point in time, went backwards. And later on, when our country was attacking people that were different and this communist scare, he wrote about that And he made books about that. And he talked about equality and everybody having a chance to live their life. Yes, sir. Okay, since he did 10 apples up on top. Okay, we'll talk about that one later, okay? So, what we need to do is we need to look at people like Dr. Seuss who are willing to do what's right, who are willing to do what's important, who are willing to say, I'll pay the price when someone else is being hurt. I'll get in the way. I have a young man that I know that when he was in high school, the big kids in school, the big guys that were the real athletes, they were picking on a little wormy guy, you know, that was kind of 4'2" and 87 pounds and his arms were this big, and they were getting ready to stick his head in the toilet. So this kid, halfway between the little guy and the big guys, he stepped between the three big guys and protected the little guy. Is that what you'd do? That's what Dr. Seuss would do. That's what Dr. Seuss did. And that's what Jesus did. He stood up for everybody else that needed help. And that's why I celebrate Dr. Seuss. Okay? Even though he did rhyme. Pray with me. Dear Jesus, thank you for coming into our lives and thank you for giving us examples of those people who put their lives in the way of those who would hurt others, to protect those who would be hurt. Help us to know when it is that you call us to be someone else's hero. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen. And as you guys get up, look at the flower, how tall he's getting. I think he's grown that much since last week. Pretty soon he'll be as tall as you guys. All right, you guys can go.
Those invisible magnetic forces at work. Let's stir up some invisible magnetic forces right now. Join with me in our call to worship. Rejoice greatly, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey, even on a donkey's colt.
Blessed is the leader who comes in the name of the Lord.
You are our God, and we will praise you.
You are our God, and we will exalt you.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His faithful love endures forever.
Amen. Join me in prayer, please. Father God, we come before you today, thanking you for the faithfulness that you display in our lives every day, and asking that you would come into our midst, that you would open our hearts and our minds to truly become more one with you, to learn, to listen, and to lean on one another as a community as we work together to reach out to the world around us. Thank you, God, for your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please rise if you are able and join with us in singing Lift Up Your Hearts, O Mighty Gates, number 176, if you wish.
Save your God, our world is.
seated.
I'm reading scripture. I wasn't planning. So we're going to do things a little bit differently over the next several weeks. I recently read a book by Marcus Borg, and it talks about the last week of Jesus' life. And I was thinking, all too often, we take and try to compress that last week into 1 week. And if we read all the scripture suggested to read on Easter or on Palm Sunday for that week, we'd have no time left for the sermon. And so what we're going to do is over the next 7 weeks, we're going to look at Holy Week, a day at a time, and spend time in every day of that week so that we as a group, as a community, can understand it. So, this morning, we're going to talk about Palm Sunday. Yes, we're a little bit early, but on Palm Sunday, you'll still be able to wave your palms. So here then, the scripture from the Gospel of Mark. Chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you are doing this, tell him the Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly." They went and found a colt outside on the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered, as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The reading of the word for the people of God. Now, special music. Do you want to introduce it, Jared?
Yeah, so this is Hunter. We'll talk about war, but he's our new choir director, so he's doing our special music this morning.
Don't clap yet, you haven't heard him.
True enough. So hello to those of you I've already met, and hello to those of you who I will meet in the coming weeks. This is Welcome to Our World. It's by Chris Rice. It's been a favorite of mine since I was young.
Tears are falling, hearts are breaking. How we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting. Welcome, Holy Child. Welcome, Holy Child. Hope that you don't mind our manger. How I wish we have known, but long awaited, holy stranger, make yourself at home. Please make yourself at home. Bring your peace into our violence, bid our hungry souls be filled. Word now breaking, heaven's silence, welcome to our world, welcome to our world. Fragile fingers sent to heal us, tender brow prepared for thorn, tiny heart whose blood will save. Unto us is born, unto us is born. wrap our injured flesh around you. Breathe our air and walk our sod. Rob our sin and make us holy, perfect Son of God. Perfect Son of God. Welcome to our
Pray with me. Great and loving Lord God, we thank you for your presence in our midst today. We thank you for the seasons that are changing, the spring that is upon us, and how we are able and enabled to glorify you. Some of us through music, some of us through teaching or preaching, and all of us through sharing your love with all that we need. Be with us today, and let the words that come from my mouth be the words from your heart. In your name, amen. Since the Jews left Moses, or led by Moses, left Egypt, they have celebrated the Passover. And the Passover just happens to coincide with Holy Week, because on the beginning of Passover is when Jesus and his disciples entered the temple. And so the Holy Week is probably the only week in the year that we celebrate something about Jesus that we know it happened that week. We don't know really when Easter happened or Christmas happened, and we don't know really when the baptism happened, and we don't know any of those things, but we do know Holy Week happened during Passover. And so on Palm Sunday, when we come together and we wave the palms, we know that that is in memory of and at the same time of year as when Jesus entered the city. And so Holy Week is really important, and when we look at it on the calendar, we have all these things that happened, and we try to smush them into a couple of little worship services, and we lose a lot of the true meaning of what happened. So over the next 7 weeks, we're going to be looking at the last week of the life of Jesus on earth. And we're going to be using the book of Mark. And I got into a conversation accidentally yesterday with one of your former interim pastors who happens to be a seminary professor. We're not naming names. And I asked him if he had ever heard of this book, and he says, well, I know Marcus Borg, and I had lunch with Marcus Borg, and the conversation went on to the point that I'm trying to find the fire alarm or some way to get out of the conversation. But it was an amazing conversation, and this book is one of those that I got it because I was challenged to, and then I started reading it, and I couldn't put it down, and I found myself answering Borg as I was reading it, and I was giving blood and reading the book, and the phlebotomist came over and asked me if I was okay, and I said, I'm just in love with this book. I don't agree with it all the time, but it's challenging me and making me grow. And as followers of Christ, I think it's important that we challenge ourselves and we read things that we might not totally agree with so that we can grow and understand and comprehend better. So we're going to be using the book of Mark, which most scholars agree was the first gospel written. And even Bob Reed agreed with me that Mark was written first. And so it should be the one that we start with. I go, wow, Bob agrees with me. So we're going to be looking at Mark. It's simple. It's to the point. It doesn't have the fluff. And it's probably, if you look beyond just the Gospels and see how they disagree, you can see how they agree, and most of them agree in every instance with what's in the book of Mark. So we're going to look at the Passion of Christ through the Gospel of Mark. Now, if we look at Jerusalem from the time of Jesus, it was a small city. It was enclosed inside a wall, and parts of that wall still stand today. And for 1,000 years before Jesus, this was the jewel of the Middle East. It was a tourist destination. It was considered the most beautiful city created. And it was created mostly by King David. And then after he died, his son Solomon had a united kingdom. All the Israeli people, all the Jewish people, the people of Judah, considered this the dwelling place of God. And over the next 850 years, it fell from grace. It was torn down. It was put in captivity. The people were sent away. And then they were allowed back. And they rebuilt the temple. And about 70 years before Jesus was born, King Herod rebuilt the temple the way it was when Jesus was there. And it's really important that we understand that this was considered by the people of Israel the dwelling place of God. Now, before Jesus was born, Israel once again fell from grace, and they were ruled by Rome. And Rome was not a tolerant ruler, was not in any way benevolent to those people that they possessed. And the monies from the local people went into the coffers of first Rome, and secondly King Herod, so he could build his temples and his palaces. He had one palace that he built on top of a 1,300-foot-high cliff with hot tubs. So every penny that was made went to King Herod. And the people got poorer and poorer. And the way the government did it was they did three things. The first thing was that they told the people that they weren't worthy of understanding how government worked. You're not smart enough. You're not educated enough. So you need to trust us. So there was that form of putting the thumb on the people and keeping them out of the know. And then the second thing that the government did was that they financially oppressed them. The wealthy people had theirs, and they got wealthier and wealthier. And the people that weren't quite so wealthy, if they had bad crops, they had to sell their land, or they had to take out a loan on their land. And then when they couldn't pay back the loan, the wealthy people got their land. And most of these wealthy people were absentee landlords, like the guy in the parable from a couple weeks ago. And so the wealthy got wealthier, the poor got poorer, and they lived hand to mouth, barely surviving. But it was okay because of the third thing that they did to keep the people in line. They told them that that's what God wanted. And so the people of Israel were poorer and poorer and more oppressed, not just by Rome, but by the high priest and the Sanhedrin and the teachers of the law. They were more and more oppressed. And King Herod, smart as he was, found his rich friends, his benefactors, and said, "You give me money, and I will give you a position on the Sanhedrin in the temple." So the wealthy got wealthier, the poor got poorer, and they were oppressed. Oh, not by Herod, but by God. And so the people were hungry, and they were ready, and they were wanting change. So before we change from the map, there are two entrances to the temple that would have been used that day. The first one is off to your right, which would be called the Golden Gate. That was the entrance straight into the temple and into the courtyard. And that's the one that Jesus would have used on that day. On the other side is probably the Damascus Gate would have been used. And that's the one, that Pontius Pilate, the governor, was using that very day. Pontius Pilate lived over on the Mediterranean in a town that was built special for him, partially by Herod and partially by Rome, for the governor. Sandy beaches and beautiful coastline. But when there was high holidays, like Passover, there was more likelihood that the people would be angry, more likelihood that the people would rebel. And so Pontius Pilate brought his Roman troops to town to protect them. And he came. And so he would have come in the other gate. Almost simultaneously, they're coming in the gates. So, that Palm Sunday, that day, Jesus on top of the Mount of Olives, looking over the city. And this is the Palm Sunday walk as it looks today. Coming down the Mount of Olives from the top of the hill, coming down to the Garden of Gethsemane, across the Kidron Valley, and up the hill to the walled city. Celebrated every Palm Sunday. Thousands upon thousands of people, Christians from around the world, gathering to make that walk. The first time I made the walk, about 30-some years ago, I was there as a guest, and we were on top of the Mount of Olives, and an amazing sight looking down the hill and across at the city, at the Golden Dome. And I was there, and a Presbyterian pastor was standing next to me, and he realized that he set his camera down. So the tour guide starts walking down the pathway, down the walk, and I'm helping this guy find his camera. We turned around after he found his camera, and there was nobody we knew. We were alone on top of the Mount of Olives, trying to make the Palm Sunday walk down the hill. And we were guests of the Israeli government. And so the Israeli government had told us, do not talk to anybody. If you see somebody with brown skin, ignore them. They are evil people. They will steal everything you've got. So don't talk to them. Okay, we're in a foreign country where they speak Arabic and Hebrew and we barely speak English. And all these people around, and none of them are American, and none of them speak English that we know of, and if they have brown skin, we're told to ignore them. And so we're slowly wandering down this winding trail that has forks off to this way and forks off this way and into cemeteries and into shops, and I'm getting a little nervous. And finally, to make a long story short, we had no choice. We saw a vendor, and we told him what was going on. And he said, who's your tour guide? And I said, Eitan. He said, Eitan went by here about a minute and a half ago. Go down this way, take a left, and you'll beat him to the bottom of the hill. And found out that, all the Palestinians are not bad people, and all brown people are not evil. But it was kind of frightening. But Jesus made that Palm Sunday walk the first time. And why did he go on a donkey, a colt that had never been ridden? Fulfillment of prophecy. The Jewish people were waiting for a king. The Jewish people were waiting for a leader. The Jewish people, they're oppressed, they're poor, they're hungry, they have no hope. Their only hope comes from God and their scriptures. The book of Zephaniah says the king will come humbly, riding on a colt. So Jesus is riding on a colt. Is this our king? Is this the one who's going to deliver us? Who's going to fill our stomachs and our coffers and give our land back to us? There was hope. Hope that had been missing for a long time. There was hope that just maybe God was going to hear their fervent prayers. And so he came into the city. But at the same time, from the other side, in comes the Roman soldiers. Their parade. Their axes, their swords, their armor, a ruthless and powerful army coming in this gate, representing all that was wrong with their world, while in the other side comes the king with an army of palm leaves on a donkey. How more different can they be? The Roman parade represents all of the oppression, all of the pain, all of the things that they do not want or like, and yet it's their reality. But maybe, just maybe, this king that's coming in from the other side is going to be the answer. I'm reading this book, as I've said before, The Last Week by Marcus Borg. And if you want to be challenged, I'd suggest you go to Half Price Books and get this. It's about $7. It's a great read. If you want to wait until it's all beat up and stuff, you can borrow mine. It's one of those books, kind of like a Dean Koontz novel, that after you start reading it, you can't put it down. And yesterday, I was here in the morning, and I set it down, and I couldn't find it. And I thought, oh, no, I lost it. So when I got back from Seattle, it was still there, so I picked it up, and I put some notes in it, and I was going to take it home with me, and I got home. I couldn't find it. It was on the table again. It's a good book, and it's worth the read, and it makes you think about the juxtaposition between Jesus on the colt and Pilate in his chariot, surrounded by soldiers, and how the two of them could and would come together, and how the world would be changed by that happen. On one hand, we have Jesus. On a colt, peaceful, not a warrior. But in reality, he knows about the politics of the day. He knows about the challenge. He knows about the risk that he is taking. And he willingly accepts what God has in store for him. He willingly accepts the mantle. And at this point in time, he's already realized that the mantle that he is going to wear is that of sacrifice. On the other hand, we have Pontius Pilate, the leader of the country. He is not in himself an evil man. He is led by a country, and he knows that if he violates what Caesar wants, he is dead. He had some real gifts and some real skills, and he was able to govern Jerusalem and all of Israel for some time before it all started to crumble in on him, and he basically disappeared from the face of the earth. But we have to choose Jesus or Pilate, the Prince of Peace who comes on a colt, or the Prince who is in a chariot of gold. It's up to us to choose. As Grace Baptist Church, as followers of the Christ, we're so often given the opportunity, the mandate, if you will, to choose Jesus or Pilate, the palm leaves or the sword. Sometimes we have to take a stand. Once upon a time, when I was in my early 20s, I had two friends, Bill, who, when I told him that he was a racist SOB and that he needed to change, he looked at me and he said, "Boy, you have to pick your battles carefully. Only pick a battle, only shed your blood if you're willing to lose, if you're willing to pay the price." And the other one was Tommy Pearson, and he basically said the same thing. In other words, when I told him that I thought, and forgive me, black people are not second-class citizens, and he said that if I kept talking like that, and he was warning me as a friend, somebody's going to hurt you Are you willing to pay the price? Are we willing to pay the price? Are we willing to stand with Jesus as he tries to overthrow a world that doesn't understand, that doesn't care? A world that is interested only in preserving the system and not protecting the poor. What would Jesus do? Precious God, we thank you for your presence in our midst today, and we ask that you be with us in such a way that we may know your calling upon us, may understand the gospel, and may truly live a life for you. In your name, amen. One of the ways that we commit to truly serving our God is by joining with Jesus in breaking the bread, in drinking from the cup, so that we can have the strength and the courage and the knowledge and the fellowship of the rest of the body, that we may truly serve God. And so in a moment, we're going to serve communion to all those who desire to be at one with God. And just in case you don't know, the coronavirus is in our state. And the Council of Ministries met this week and talked about what we're going to do to make sure that we do everything to protect those who are vulnerable. And the first thing we're going to do is Pastor Gordy and the communion stewards are going to use the hand sanitizer to make sure that we don't communicate germs to you. Then next week, we're going to have masks if anybody needs it. We're going to invite you, if you think you might have this horrible bug, to stay home. Damien and I are going to be working, Damien doesn't know it yet, on making sure that the music and the sermon are available so that if you need to stay home to protect yourself and others, you can still get the work and the word. So first, I think Jessica and Gabe are going to help me this morning. See, we're killing those germs. And the health department says that the best thing that you can do, the most important thing you can do, is regularly wash your hands, sanitize them periodically, and try to stand 6 feet away from people that you don't know and love so that you don't share those bugs with them. All right? So we have gathered together to worship God, to know that our God is a God of grace and of hope and of peace. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he offered it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take this, eat this in remembrance of me." It was a means of strengthening them, encouraging them for the life that they had ahead, filled with uncertainty, filled with a degree of hopelessness, but filled with hope because of Jesus. After they had eaten, Jesus took the cup. He filled the cup and he offered it to his disciples, saying, "This is my blood of the new covenant, my blood, which is shed for you." If his blood is shed for us, then hopefully our blood won't need to be shed for him. But if it is, we gladly and openly accept what God has in store for us. And so he offered to his disciples the bread and the cup, hoping that they would know and understand and appreciate what God had done for them, was doing for them. In a moment, we're going to open the table, and you will be offered the bread, and you will dip the bread into the cup. One bread, one body, one cup. We're not licking the cup, so you're okay. And we will be fellowshipping with each other and with God. May I have a prayer?
Lord, as we take this bread, we remember that you are the bread of life. You feed our souls, you nourish our hearts, and you give us sustenance to run the race before us. Lord, as we drink from this cup, we remember that you are the giver of life, and the giver of forgiveness, and the giver of hope. You bring deep peace to our souls, and may your love flow within us. Amen.
Amen. the bread of life, the cup of salvation given for you. The table is open. Precious God, we come into your midst to love you and to serve you, to love and serve our neighbors. Be with us today and help us to see you. In your name, amen. Please be seated.
God is the giver of all good gifts. Take just a few seconds to think about all the blessings and wonderful gifts that he's brought into your life just in the last 7 days since the last time we met together. He fills our hearts with good things, and he gives us the opportunity to share those good things with the world around us. And I would invite the ushers to come forward and wait upon us And I would invite you to open your hearts to share all those good things God has given you each and every day. Thank you.
Yesterday, several of us from Grace went to Seattle, to Seattle First Baptist Church for the Evergreens World's Fair, and what an amazing event. My sadness is that only five of us from Grace made it, but the joy is what an amazing facility, amazing food, and oh, one of us won the raffle for a $350 basket of goodies. And so, and rumor has it he's not sharing. If you didn't go, you missed a great day. What an amazing historic building. It was just breathtaking walking through that church. And the fellowship was good. So this morning, this is a joy. 251 breakfasts were served. So that's a joy, but also a concern that there's that level of need in our community. Also, Selma didn't go with us yesterday because she thought going to a reveal party of the gender of her grandchild was more important than spending time with us. And it's a... Oh, I thought you said this morning you knew. Okay, okay. So she knows, but she's not telling. Okay. So that's a joy. So, Lynn Fermo asks that we pray for her son, Bob. He's in the hospital for unknown issues, but they do know that it was not a heart attack. So that's a joy, but still concern. Continued prayers for Larry as he recovers from his surgery. Prayers for those who are afraid and those who are impacted by and those of us who could be impacted by the coronavirus. Just keep that in your prayers. Many people in our midst are facing uncertainty and drug addiction and depression and the reality of living in this world, and let's keep them in our prayers. Susie says she has a prayer to celebrate because she didn't miss the meeting yesterday because it wasn't yesterday. So prayers for Susie. Pray for Essie. She has some medical concerns that she's not ready to share yet, I think, but let's keep Essie in our prayers. Lori says, please continue to pray for her family. Things are starting to stabilize a little bit, but she also wants us to pray and pray for her that she can find that elusive job. And thank God the weather is getting better and it's almost spring. Okay. Dan asks us to pray for his next door neighbor. She just found out that she has stage 4 lung cancer that has metastasized. And so let's keep Dan's neighborhood and especially his neighbor in our prayers. A special thank you to God for answering our prayers and bringing us some amazing musicians today. Be with us in prayer. Precious God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, for answering us, and for putting us in a position to glorify you. We ask that you continue to shower those in our midst with blessings. Continue to shower those who are not with us, those who are our friends, our family, our enemies, and those that we don't know, with your blessings. We ask for your healing touch for our community, for our world. Let your love spread in such a way that hatred is a thing of the past, that violence is no longer considered appropriate, and that we can live together, sister and brother, black and white. Allow us to be your people. You have heard our concerns, and we lift them to you, the concerns that we have shared and those that we have shared with you in our hearts. We ask for your blessing. In Christ's name, amen.
This is our opportunities for ministry moment. I'd like to have Jared come up and share a little more detail about our great big momentous occasion.
So I would like to officially announce and welcome Hunter Dunn as our new choir director. He was hired, today's his first Sunday. So we're going to be starting up the choir soon. We just have to coordinate rehearsal schedule. So an announcement on that will be coming soon. So if you're interested in singing in the choir, see myself or Hunter about it, and we'll let you know when rehearsals will be.
And who's the young lady with her that sings so well?
It's Carrie, his girlfriend.
That's great. Now, here's one we all need to remember. Next Sunday is daylight savings time. So if you forget, you know, it's spring ahead, right? So don't forget to do that ahead, or you'll be joining us for fellowship rather than worship. This last week, we sent out the newsletter for the next quarter, the next 3 months ahead, and we send it via email, and then we print a few that for people who don't do such things as email. But if you did not get a copy, please see me or Gordy and let us know so that we can make sure you get a copy. If you're not on the email list and you would like to get a newsletter by email, please see me or Gordy. Thank you very much. Also, Nadine's getting ready to put out a new directory, a 2020 directory. I'm going to lay this out on the food table, and it has forms. If you are not in the directory, please fill out a form so that we can get you in. If you are in the directory but there's something wrong with the listing, just cross out what's there and make your corrections on the actual page in the directory. We appreciate that. Let's see. We have our women's and men's Bible study. I believe the women's Bible study started, they meet Tuesday, Wednesday. You started your new study last week, right?
Yes.
And that's Growing Through Life's Challenges, I believe. It's something like that. And the men's Bible study is just finishing up Exodus, and then they're going to be starting a new one pretty soon. Also, Pastor Gordy will be doing baptism and new member classes on the 8th and the 15th of March in preparation for a great celebration on Easter Sunday of welcoming new members. And the Christian Ed Committee has announced that there will be an Easter egg hunt again this year. It's being done in conjunction with the mission team. It's something that we weren't sure of, so it didn't get in the opportunities for ministry brochure that we put out earlier in the year. So we want to make sure that you know about it. There will be a sign-up sheet soon. There are various ways you can either help on the day or in preparation of, and many hands make light work. Are there any other announcements I might have missed? Oh, I didn't mention Growing Grace Through Our Gifts, which is the 15th of March. So it's a week from next Saturday, 3 to 5. Please do consider being there to be a part of the great things that we are learning and the ways in which we want to bless the future of this congregation. Okay, that having been said, our final hymn is not the one listed because it got changed after printing. The hymn that we're doing is Hosanna, right?
Yes, Hosanna Loud, Hosanna, number 267.
Please rise and sing along.
Jesus, who are blessed, those called in whom is blessed.
the followers of the Christ waved the palm leaves in celebration of the entrance of the King, may we go forth waving ours in our hearts, at least, that we may rejoice and share the good news that Christ is our King. In the name of God the Father, Jesus the King, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.